Good morning, everyone, and happy Valentine's Day. Before we begin, I want to acknowledge the land that this church sits upon. As we gather on this sacred land, we acknowledge that this is the Dish with One Spoon territory created in treaty by the Anishinaabe, Mississauga, and Haudenosaunee, binding them to share and protect this land. Subsequent Indigenous nations and peoples, Europeans and all newcomers, have been invited into this treaty in the spirit of peace, friendship, and respect. May we faithfully fulfill our treaty commitments to the land and its people. Well, welcome this morning. If you're new with us at St. Philip's, it's wonderful to have you join us. Check out our webpage. In there you can find our contact information. I'd love to hear from you. A reminder that this Wednesday we begin Lent. Ash Wednesday is coming up in just 3 days, and at 7 p.m. there will be a service held from here on Zoom, and you'll use the same link that you just used to get into this service. So use the Sunday at 10:30 link, and that will get you to the Ash Wednesday service. A word about the service: there will be an opportunity during the service to impose ashes on yourself at home. If you have a fireplace, you might have some ashes, or maybe a candle, you can use the wick of the candle to get a bit of a little smudge on your thumb, or you can just use water. So there will be an opportunity at the service to do that, or if you live with someone else, you can impose ashes on one another. So just be ready for that at the service. A reminder, our vestry meeting, annual vestry meeting, is coming up on February 27th on Zoom. That and all kinds of other information and details are in the pre-service announcements that scroll by before the service, and they are now on the homepage of our website under the News and Events heading. So homepage, stphillips.ca, News and Events, and you'll find a link to get the announcements for this week. And there's all kinds of details there on three different ways you can spend Lent: cracking open white identity, becoming who we are, and a feast for the earth. So check all that out. There's also information there about a farewell party for Bishop Jenny on February 21st, about the annual Black Anglican service on February 28th, which I highly commend to you. Also information about our own regular weekly compliment and centering prayer services, and about how you can donate to WAYS, our local feed bank, or to FaithWorks, our diocesan outreach organization, or to St. Philip's. Now it's time to get settled in for worship. Light a candle, dim the lights, arrange your seating, fluff your pillow, whatever it needs, whatever it takes you to make you most attentive for worship. And then join in, sing, pray, dance, play your tambourines. Let's hear the word together and be blessed. But first, let's prepare our hearts in a moment of silence before our worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have again brought us together on the Lord's Day to praise you for your goodness and to ask your blessing. Give us grace to see your hand in the week that is past, and your purpose in the week to come, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, if there's any children out there, gather around your screens, and I think Rachel has a word or two to share with you.
Good
Amen. Thanks, Rachel. We're going to sing the hymn, "We Have Come at Christ's Own Bidding." Just a word, Tracy just pointed out to me that the very last phrase of verse 3 is missing in the service leaflet online. So the last few words are, "People of the God we bless," if you remember. The last 5 words of the hymn, "People of the God we bless." Dear friends in Christ, as we turn our hearts and minds to worship Almighty God, let us confess our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Merciful God, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of glory, by the grace of your Spirit, reveal your Son to us now in the message of the prophets and in the witness of the apostles, so that we may heed his voice and receive him in faith. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Now we listen for the word of God in Scripture. Thanks be to God. I invite you to join with me in saying the first six verses of Psalm number 50. I'll say the first half of each verse if you'll respond to the second. O holy God, our holy God has spoken and proclaimed the world from east to west.
Out of Zion, God shines forth in radiant beauty, coming not in silence, but as a consuming fire, a mighty tempest raging all around.
O Holy One, you summon heaven above and the whole world to judge your people.
You say, gather my faithful people who have covenanted with me by sacrifice.
Let the heaven declare my faithful justice.
Surely our God is our judge.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let's make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them. And from the cloud there came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Before I begin my sermon today, I neglected to mention earlier, we are a very, we take COVID precautions very seriously here at St. Philip's. And if you're visiting with us or if you're new here, you might be wondering why the four of us are here, no masks, and we're singing together. Well, we all live in the same household, and so we're allowed to do that. Just wanted to make that clear, because we do take that very seriously. And may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So the last Sunday after Epiphany, we hear stories of transfiguration, a word usually defined as a change in shape or appearance to reveal something greater, more beautiful or holier, something that was already there, but we now see it more fully. The story of the transfiguration of Jesus on the mountain is, I think, a familiar one to all, if not most of us. Before the eyes of his three companions, Peter, James, and John, Jesus is transfigured. He shines with and in the glory of God with Elijah and Moses, those two great figures of the Old Testament. And then God speaks from inside a dark cloud. Jesus is transfigured from being a man who, for his disciples, seems to speak God's wisdom and possess God's power. He goes from that to being part of that holiness that is God. If they had a sense of this truth before, well, now they've seen it. And the enormity of that sinks in. On this day, we usually focus on the transfigured Christ and stand in awe of the one whose presence we still share in as a community of his followers. But I want to focus elsewhere. I want to spend just a few minutes thinking about the transfiguration of the disciples. So we began our little jaunt through scripture this morning with the story of Elijah's ascension into heaven. His absolute faith in God and his willingness to go wherever God leads him opens him up fully to the glory of God. And in that moment, with the vision of a fiery chariot and horses, he is completely transfigured. He is so filled with holiness that he ascends to heaven. Another way of saying that he becomes one, completely one with God. He has totally given himself in loving devotion to God, and God has lovingly filled him with divine blessing to the point where this transfiguration occurs. Elisha, his mentor, or his disciple, I guess, was already aware of his mentor's close connection with God. But in seeing this vision of Elijah being taken up, Elisha himself is made holier. He gets a double share of Elijah's spirit. He is transfigured and is now seen by his own followers as such. This story gives us a picture of the intimate kind of unity God desires for each one of us. A unity that is possible the more we let go of what keeps us from God. A unity that is possible when our hearts and minds are fully given to God. And what of Peter, James, and John, who witnessed the transfiguration of Jesus? Are they transfigured? Well, I think the answer is yes and no. If you continue reading Mark's gospel to the end, you'll find that these three don't really seem to change much. It's like they had this light bulb go off on the mountain and they kind of forgot about it later. They continue to follow Jesus with great devotion, and he continues to teach them amazing things which they never seem to understand. In the end, they all betray him, even Peter, who said he would never deny Jesus. When things get a little too hot, he claims not to have ever known Jesus. Now, Mark's gospel, minus the last 10 or so verses, which were added later by someone else to fit more smoothly with the stories of Luke and Matthew, it finishes with an empty tomb and the women fleeing in terror, having been told by an angel to go to tell the disciples to go and meet Jesus in Galilee. Mark's gospel ends in, well, mystery and chaos. But, and I've mentioned this before, but it's worth saying again, this is the clever thing about how Mark tells the story, in the knowledge that those fleeing women have of a risen Jesus waiting to meet us. We have a choice. We know about the empty tomb. We can just continue to be afraid and confused and refuse to hear or believe the angel's message. Or we can, with all our flaws and faithlessness, decide to take a chance on the possibilities that there are when we remember the glory of God that was present in Jesus on that mountaintop and that couldn't be contained in a burial tomb. So, are Peter, James, and John transfigured? In one sense, no. They have a moment of epiphany on the mountaintop, but then end up kind of falling away. But what if Mark, in composing his story, intends that we are Peter, James, and John, now living in the knowledge of the resurrection, because we have read to the end of the story? What if we, Jesus' faithful disciples, go back to the beginning of Mark's story and choose to follow the risen Christ throughout that story, carrying our own cross? What if we meet Jesus up in Galilee and follow him into the Jordan River and are baptized, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and proclaimed as God's own beloved? What if, empowered by the Spirit, we then go and face our own demons in the desert and let go of what distracts us from fully trusting in God? What if, in the power of God and with Jesus our companion, what if we choose God's way and not the path of false security, pride, and power that this world offers us? What if we, filled with God's power and with Jesus at our side, go out and share the good news in word and in deed, bring healing, comfort, love, and hope into the lives of those whom we encounter along the way, just like Jesus? What if we, strengthened in the presence of the Holy Spirit and encouraged by Christ in our hearts, speak truth to power, speak truth to the powers of this world where they cause suffering and hatred? What if we climb that mountain, keeping our eyes on our Sherpa, Jesus, who will guide us safely? What if we get to the top and discover ourselves in the glowing, brilliant, pleasant presence of God and the whole community of the saints? Jesus is fluorescent, but you know what? So are you. In that moment, the eternal reality that we all exist in God's love and being shines forth. And like Jesus, like Moses and Elijah, like the whole glorious company of the saints, all is transfigured. The beauty of God shining from within us is revealed. You, Peter, James, John, Bob, Mary, Jack, and Jill, were all transfigured in Christ. And living in the bright light of this new reality, we continue our walk with Jesus, each carrying our cross as we share that light, now shining from our hearts into the world. No fear too great to throw us off course, even if our cross leads us to completely giving ourselves out of love for God and for others to crucifixion and even to death. Because we know the truth of the resurrection, in Christ, our companion on the way, we know the fullness of God and live into that every day. And in God, we know that even death itself is only another step along the path with Jesus. So, are Peter, James, and John transfigured? Is the beauty and glory of God within them revealed? As Mark's gospel proceeds, I'm not sure they are, but if I'm right in how Mark wants us to enter into his story from the beginning, but now with the knowledge of that empty tomb, then you are Peter, James, and John. And the only question is, will you enter into the story? The invitation to go down that path shouts out to us from the pages of Mark's gospel. Will you turn around and go back to find the risen Jesus in Galilee as the angel directs us at the empty tomb? Will you trust in the power and love of God and so become transfigured, becoming a light for all the world to see? That is the question I hear arising out of Mark's story of the transfiguration of Jesus. And I'll leave it with you. All I will say is that in this troubled world, there is more need than ever for us to be that brilliant light by following Jesus and giving ourselves for the sake of the world. Amen. Please join in singing Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know it, you'll know it by the time we're finished. Please join in.
Jesus Christ. Cast not my darkness, speak to me. Lord Jesus Christ, your light shines within us. Let my heart always welcome your love.
Now in these ancient words of Scripture, let us affirm our faith together. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and the great commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. And now I invite you into a time of prayer. Come to that time in our service where we offer ourselves to God in service, symbolized by the gift of the money we offer to support the ministry here at St. Philip's. So following our hymn, Transform Us, I will bless the offerings that have come in this week. I invite you to join in singing. Let us pray. Holy God, receive all we offer you this day and bring us to that radiant glory which we see in the transfigured face of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive those sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Just a reminder, if you'd like to stick around for our virtual coffee hour, just do so, and we'll begin that right after the organ postlude. Now let's sing our final hymn, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies. May God keep you in all your days. May Christ shield you in all your ways. May the Spirit bring you healing and peace. May the Holy Trinity drive all darkness from you and pour upon you blessing and light. Amen.